Okay, we're fortunate to speak with Dr. Matthew Cook, one of the keynote speakers for the Exosome conference that we're at. Thank you, Dr. Cook.
Oh, I'm delighted to be here. Thanks so much.
Yeah, we had the fortune or misfortune or luck of meeting years ago. And since then, your path of being an anesthesiologist, director of a surgery center has morphed somewhat into regenerative medicine. Tell us the name of your clinic.
Well, my clinic is called BioReset Medical.
BioReset. So you were kind of a cog in a machine of treating people. Now you're actually doing something that can help. Tell us what it's like to be a clinical anesthesiologist versus a healer now.
Oh, it's kind of amazing. What I did was I ran a surgery center, and so my specialty was doing nerve blocks. And so what I did was I would look with an ultrasound, and I would look at every nerve in the body, and then put that nerve or group of nerves to sleep to numb a part of the body that was asleep, and then we would do surgery. And most of the time, I wouldn't even have to do general anesthesia because I would just give a little sedation because the patients wouldn't feel any pain. And what that evolved into was I actually found out that if I put something other than local anesthetic around nerves, I could start to heal nerve pain. And one of those things that I use is exosomes. And so I developed a practice that is part interventional pain and part integrative medicine, where I'm putting together all of the pieces to create a comprehensive healthcare strategy for people, both with super complex illness and as kind of an anti-aging wellness strategy.
Okay, so you trained at UC San Francisco and you developed this artistry of finding nerves. I just took a course in ultrasound injections, and it's such a beautiful art, seeing the nerve, seeing the sheath hydrodissected. That's an art. But up until recently, until 2 years ago, when you started using exosomes, there wasn't much we could use to actually heal. We could numb them for a while or kill them. But what kind of things did you start out with before exosomes?
So the first thing that came out in the market was actually 5% dextrose. So if you think traditionally back for 60 years, people have been treating joints with something called prolotherapy. And that's where they take a solution of dextrose that's about 15%. So it's a hypertonic, concentrated amount of dextrose that people are put in the joints and they're put in the ligaments and tendons. Turns out that if you put dextrose that's 15% around a nerve, it's much too hot and nerves don't like it. And so people started to find out that at a concentration of about 5% dextrose, there are some benefits to nerves, both in terms of decreasing pain, because the dextrose is a little bit of an analgesic. Mm. And then more importantly, if we look with an ultrasound and then we use fluid to surround the nerve, we can either do a block around the nerve or we can do a hydrodissection where we relieve an entrapment.
Oh.
And so I've used platelet poor plasma, which is basically plasma from the blood combined with platelet-rich plasma. I've used placental matrix. I've used every type of exosome that there is. I've used amniotic fluid. I've used stem cells, and I've actually used a fat. And so I've made nano fat,
wow,
or micro fat, and then used an ultrasound to put that around nerves.
So in your clinical experience, which is vast, perhaps more than anyone, with the range of modalities, how does exosome therapy compare with what you've done in the past?
Exosomes are probably the best treatment for nerves that I know of, number one. Number two, the way that they're manufactured creates an extremely consistent result.
I see.
And a lot of people are going to require more than one treatment. A lot of people might require two or three or four treatments. And so the ability to have a consistent product that you can use again and again, almost like a drug, is quite appealing.
Let's talk about common neuropathies, because that's really what we're talking about. I think a lot of people have spinal nerve problems. Obviously, that's very common. Sciatic nerve, cervical spine nerve. Another common problem would be, carpal tunnel from repetitive use. You can also get neuralgias post-herpetically. Some people have palsies post-surgically. I have a friend who had an inguinal nerve palsy and resulting in, you know, hip flexor problems. So there's a myriad of ways you can disconnect electrical circuits.
That's right.
So what would you say are the top five indications that you're treating with your techniques?
So I'll start with where you started, back pain. Back pain is probably one of the biggest problems that we face from a healthcare system. So in terms of treating nerves, we have a comprehensive approach where we do diagnostic ultrasound and an MRI, and we figure out exactly what's going on, and then we do a complex neurological exam as well as a physical exam, and I look at the kinetic chains of what's happening. Then the common things that I will treat, I'll treat facets, I'll treat the epidural space, I will treat the disc, and I'll also treat a muscle attachment, so I might treat the transverse process, and then I will also treat fascial planes. And so I'll treat the fascial plane around the erector spinae, which is the muscles that are the big muscles that you see in the low back. I'll also treat the fascial planes around the smaller muscles that you may or may not, a lot of people may have not, that are listening may or may not have heard of, for example, quadratus femoral. And interestingly, these are all anesthesia techniques that I do, and I'm just, instead of putting an epidural steroid in, we're putting exosomes in, and instead of doing a nerve block to the quadratus femoral plane, I'm putting something that's more anti-inflammatory and has a longer-term regenerative effect. We do an enormous amount of spine. I treat a lot of peripheral neuropathy, and peripheral neuropathy is probably my second favorite condition to treat, and part of that is because nobody else treats it. There's no good known treatment for that. And what I tell people is, sometimes, not all the times, when I treat peripheral nerves, peripheral neuropathy, and I put the solution of the exosomes around the nerve, the pain will go away faster from exosomes than using 2% lidocaine.
Oh my God. That's interesting. Yeah, I think there are some immediate effects I've noticed. Well, tell me one thing. So, you know, a nerve runs a long way. There's an axon. It's got its main body in the spinal cord. How would, let's say you had a peripheral nerve injury, how would injecting something around the axonal part of the nerve, how does that even work? Does that heal the nerve, or do you always have to go central?
No, you don't always have to go central. And so often I feel like with peripheral nerve injuries, it's almost better to treat peripheral. Sometimes an injury, there's what we like to call multiple birds on the wire. So if someone may have some spinal cord injury or there's some inflammation of the nerve root coming out of the spine, they may also have some impingement in a couple of different places. But if the peripheral neuropathy is the primary etiology, helping those other areas is helpful, but when you put something regenerative around a peripheral nerve, you're healing not just the nerve, but the supporting structures in that space, turning inflammation off in that space, and you're also actually often putting fluid around the artery. Mm. And so there's, and I notice an improvement in vascular health of a lot of these people. Mm. And interestingly, we do a lot of IV therapy to support the injection therapy we do.
I love that, how you're doing the holistic,
yeah,
nutritional. Tell me one thing. I know there's some people who are claiming to have good results with CNS disorders. And, you know, I used to watch a lot of epidurals, and, you know, they would tilt the patient in back, head down, or, you know, we're using an isotonic, not hyper, you know, baric type of solution. But if you were treating somebody with C-spine problems, right, could you inject them where it's safer, down in the lumbar, and then just tilt them? Or how does the fluid dynamics work?
So a couple of ways that you can approach that. So one is you can put an intrathecal injection in the lumbar area and then put their head down. So that's option number one. Option number two is you could put an epidural catheter in the lumbar area and then thread that catheter all the way up to the neck and then deploy exosomes in the cervical epidural space,
yeah,
which I do. Then number three, and maybe the best, is that with fluoroscopy and ultrasound, we can look at the intrathecal space at C1-2, and then do and put fluid into the intrathecal space, which is the fluid around the spinal cord, basically right below the brain. And it takes a lot of planning and coordination and mapping to understand the physiology of that.
Yeah, yeah. So of course you have the fluoroscopy and the ultrasound and the clinical expertise, but I had a friend of mine from college who passed away from a, was presumed she had a cervical spine procedure in the epidural space, and they must have nicked an artery, probably the basilar, and she herniated her brain and died. So I think it's really scary to work around the neck just because of that. So the idea of actually shooting it down below the cauda equina and just tilting the patient makes me feel a lot better.
It's like it takes an extremely long time to become clinically proficient at treating people in and around the neck.
Yeah.
And it was what a lot of my friends call it tiger country. And but what happens is I use an ultrasound as part of my planning for the procedure, and it has powered off on that.
Yeah.
And so then what I'm doing is I'm looking at the anatomy, I'm looking at the structures, I'm planning how I'm going to go in, but then most importantly, I'm turning Doppler on, and so I know where the arteries are, the veins, and the nerves. I know where all the muscles and the fascial planes are, and then I'm looking at my needle, and if there's an artery in the way, then I'm either going to go above the artery or I'm going to go below the artery. And so
hugely, yeah, important. I think even better than fluoro is the color Doppler. Yeah,
is way better. Yeah. And so that and so where we're evolving to in spine medicine is fusion. And so even when we're doing fluoroscopy, we're taking a look at the anatomy because the anatomy is variable.
Oh yeah.
And so there may be a general anatomic concept, but each person can have quite a bit of variation.
Yeah, that I definitely agree. And you know, just going back to the back, because a third of people do have back pain, I always think like the chiropractors and the yogis are right, because you know, it's not just one thing. It could be the, as you said, the muscles. It could be the facet complex. It could be degeneration and osteophytes. It could be nerve impingement.
Yes.
By disc or by osteophytes. I mean, there's so many things that can go wrong with a back that I almost think it's sad that so many people try and do a surgery and they end up on the other side of it with less flexibility and the same pain. What's your experience with surgical treatment for back pain?
I like to tell people that I spent the first half of my life putting people to sleep and then facilitating them undergoing surgery, and I'm going to spend the second half of my life waking them up and preventing surgery. I generally feel it's worth a shot, and it's probably worth multiple shots to try to go in and heal someone with regenerative medicine before doing surgery, because the risk of getting worse from our procedures is extremely low, and the safety of our products is extremely high, particularly on the side of exosomes compared to a lot of the stem cell products that are out there. Exosomes are, I think, orders of magnitude safer than stem cells. I can tell you why. But then every injection will tend to regenerate and heal an area. So, and in the back, there are multiple pain generators. And so some people will have a couple facets. They may have fascial adhesions and strictures and certain muscle groups. They may have a kinetic chain that's dysfunctional. They may have laxity of the iliolumbar ligaments, and the ligaments, the entire posterior ligament is complex that stabilizes. So they're basically in the spine, there's a disc, and then there's all these ligaments and muscles and little tiny facet joints in the back. Well, if anything's not working, then dysfunctional movement happens, and when that happens, then the spine can't accept force evenly, and it creates torque that goes across the spine and the spinal cord where all the nerves are coming out. So our goal is to start to heal all of these areas and create stability and integrity in the spine and in those movements. What I find is that when we're able to do that, people seem to function a lot better, and it may be a little bit of a journey, but I've been extremely excited about how people do.
I agree. Because, you know, a lot of times the procedure-based specialties, you know, they look at fusions, multiple fusions, rods, discectomies. I mean, the ultimate thing is they're making the back less mobile and putting stress on the remaining functionality, right?
And the problem with spine fusion is if you stabilize two vertebrae, often that creates hypermobility at the disc above and below, and so then they end up with another surgery. And I've been, of probably everything in my career that I've been involved with, I'm probably less inspired by the surgical management of the spine than anything else that I've done. And I think that it's also a high revenue generator for hospitals and surgery centers. And so there's a lot of push and drive towards doing a lot of procedures. And I think that over the next decade, we're going to see less and less utilization as my passion is to start to train more people to do this so we can help more people.
Absolutely. Let the chips fall where they may. So if you have a problem with peripheral nerve damage, impingement, neuralgia, as well as the easy stuff, joint problems, and some of the more difficult problems, I would definitely recommend looking up Dr. Cook. Your clinic is BioReset in the Bay Area, and especially, I can't emphasize enough, C-spine is Tiger Country.
Yeah.
And you don't want somebody just futzing around up there.
That's right.
Yeah. All right, well, Dr. Cook, thank you for your expertise and time. We look forward to your lecture tomorrow.
Thank you so much.
Okay.